pillar created a works and wears simulator to allow us to better understand track wear. So here you can see their looping animation showing how track is put together with a bushing inserted through the links on one end and then a pin going through that bushing and link on the opposite end and creates a track chain as you put it together. So let's take a look at some of the features in this. They have wear simulators for both oval and elevated sprocket, and we're going to start there. In fact, we are going to start with looking at some information about the program. And we're going to look at the conditions for wear. So there's a few things needed for wear to occur on our undercarriage, whether it's on the track chain or on the sprocket. You see the sprocket in gray here. You need contact. You need them to be physically in contact with each other. So that's what first condition. Second thing that will cause wear is you need load to occur. You need pressure forcing those together. And the third is relative motion. Here you can see they have an arrow drawn in there showing that that bushing is moving or rolling against the sprocket. So that's relative motion between the two parts. When you put all three of those together, that is your formula for wear. Wear occurs when you have contact, load or pressure pushing on it, and relative motion. They equal wear. Cat also makes a good point here that when a machine is operating, it's really only the first three track pins or bushings that are in contact or have high amounts of pressure with the sprocket. So here you can see the load distribution. Pin number one in the beginning is carrying most of the load. Pin number two, medium. Pin three is light. And by the time we get to pin four, we have very little load. It's mostly carried by those first three pins. Similarly, the grousers in the ground, usually it's the first three grousers in the ground that have all the pressure or force on them. Here you can see with elevated sprocket, you still have three pins in contact and you have three under load. The fourth is just coming out of contact as it goes around. So let's go back to that oval animation. And just as a reminder here, you can see they show this color red as the stress. If we pause this at any point, there you can see we have one, two, and a little bit of pressure on the third. By the time we have to the fourth, we have very little pressure. I'm going to turn that off and start the animation again. And the other thing they're doing here is you can see that they have a nice white hash mark showing where the bushing comes in contact with the sprocket. And that is to show us relative motion. So I'm going to pause it again. So you can see when they first come in contact here, they're aligned and they're staying aligned. So there is no relative motion occurring as we follow it around until the very end. Here we have relative motion occurring. I'm going to start the animation again. And you can see that on the way out that that bushing rolls and relative motion is occurring at the top. Now, what does this mean for track wear? Well, remember, we had three ingredients. We needed contact, load, and relative motion. Down at the bottom of the track, we have contact, we have load, we saw those red stress marks, but we do not have relative motion, so the track wear is very low. Up at the top, we have contact, we have relative motion, but we do not have much load, so once again, the wear rate is very low for this track going forward. Now we can also reverse this track, so we're going to do that. And now we're tracking, this would be similar to the machine, tracking in reverse, and notice what's occurring. We still have our match mark showing where it lines up in the beginning, but our relative motion is still occurring at the top, at the very beginning. So we do have the relative motion up there. I want to turn it on so we can see the stress marks. We're going in reverse, so it's actually the top teeth that are going to be under stress. So here you can see the red mark showing the stress on the first three pins at the top. In this scenario, we have our load, relative motion, and contact all occurring in the same region up at the top, and that is going to cause accelerated track wear, particularly with the sprocket and the external bushings. So this is showing why tracks wear much faster in reverse than they do in forward. It's often a difficult concept for people to understand, but they don't realize the relative motion, the way the track is set up, and the relative motion that's occurring. We also can turn on the a match mark that's going to go through the center of the pin, and we'll put it back on forward. And here you can see that is showing our relative motion internally between the pin and bushing. I'm going to pause the video, and here you can see that is occurring. This was tracking in forward, and we do have relative motion internally occurring in the forward direction. So that will cause internal wear. However, if you recall, sealed and lubricated tracks, known as salt tracks, are designed to prevent and greatly reduce that internal wear. All right, so let's go back and look at some more facts about tracks. Starting here with the areas of wear. So there's a few places a track will wear. This is first picture showing the forward drive side wear occurs in that region. It's wearing into the bushing, and it's also going to wear into the sprocket on the forward side of it. That's from tracking in forward. We have reverse drive side wear. That's a little closer to the root, but occurring on the opposite side. That's wear in reverse. So it is possible when you examine these track components, you can tell if the most wear was occurred by operation in reverse or operating in forward. Root area wear occurs down in the center of the sprocket area in the bottom of the bushing. You have forward drive tip wear, which is going to occur up near the tip, up near the end. And then you would also have reverse drive side tip wear. Internal pin and bushing wear generally always occurs in this area. That's why when they do get worn out, you can turn pins and bushings and restore the clearances in there and the track pitch. Speaking of track pitch, we'll look at that next. Track pitch is the distance between the center of the bushing board to the center of the pin. There's dimensions when it's new, but as that track wears internally, that track pitch will get longer. It's not that the track stretches, but the internal clearances allow the pins to move further apart, increasing the distance between center to center. So here they're showing the center of a loose bushing in the sprocket root, basically where they should be sitting. But as they get longer, they're going to ride up higher on the tips and cause more tip wear. Now, there are several types of track that can help prevent some of the wear. So we talked about that salt track, sealed and lubricated. Here you can see a cutaway of it. This red material on here is usually a heavy oil. There's usually a rubber or plastic plug sealing it in there, but notice it has an internal cavity that can get them flow into the area between it and the bushing, which keeps it lubricated. And as long as that oil is in there, it greatly reduces the amount of internal pin and bushing wear that occurs. Now there's positive pin retention track, that those pins are held in by a snap ring in each end. Heavy duty track, here you can see it's still sealed and lubricated track, but the bushing is stepped up in the center. It's thicker. That's going to give it a longer life. There's more metal for it to wear through. Rotating bushing has another set of seals, and it actually allows the center bushing to rotate when it comes in contact, which can greatly reduce, basically would eliminate relative movement and greatly reduce the amount of track wear. This would be a good choice for a machine that must back up frequently and does that a large part of its life. Rotating bushing will prevent that type of reverse wear. Now, CAT's illustration here is showing the benefit of their extended life undercarriage. Regular tracks will wear so far, and then they reach this point where they can, in the center here, where they would benefit by turning the pin and bushings. By doing that, you would restore the track pitch and be able to get more usable life out of the track. Now, I think it would be at least 50% more life, probably a little longer for some tracks. I'm not sure that this is clearly showing exactly or accurately where that stands. What CAT is touting is saying their extended life undercarriage will go the same amount of time. It's going to have the internal wear. It's going to need the pin and bushing turn, but then it will get that much again life. It'll get 100% more life. And at that point, the whole track chain would need to be replaced. You can only return pins and bushings once effectively in the life of the tracks. Some of the benefits that allow them to do that is they have greater link height. They have more material on the bottom of the links, giving increased working clearance, and also more wear material there. Now, greased and lubricated track is another one. Not quite as good as sealed track, but they'll put a heavy grease in there. Notice it uses a solid pin, but it still has a lubricant in there that has seals on the outside. So let's take a look at our elevated sprocket machine. We'll start again with looking at the areas of stress. We saw a picture before, but here you can see them as it comes into contact. The first pin is the greatest, and as each subsequent pin comes in contact, the stress area decreases. We'll go back to looking at our match marks. Notice that when we're traveling in forward, there's no relative motion occurring in this first section. The relative motion is occurring on the way out, where the least amount of stress is. So same thing, we do not have much track wear in forward. Now I'm going to turn on that internal hash mark. And let's see if we can pause it. So here you can see when they're first coming in contact that we do have relative motion occurring internally around there. But if we have sealed and lubricated tracks, that's going to have a low amount of wear. Another neat feature on this one is we can turn on that rotating bushing track that we saw. Remember, rotating bushing track is going to allow that center bushing to rotate or spin in the sprocket. That's allowing it to stay in contact all the way around there, so there is no relative motion in this case, not until the track comes out of contact. Now, if we reverse this, notice here we still have that rotating bushing track on, and you can see how those match marks are lined up all the way around. So this is eliminating that normal relative motion that causes extreme wear in reverse. If we go back to a regular track, here you can see in reverse that we still have relative motion occurring and we'll have that wear. This also has options for us that we can flip to a worn track. So here you can see how the teeth are sharper and how the bushings are riding up higher on the sprocket area. And packing, it almost looks like snow, but you can picture it like a mud material, showing how that track would sit up higher. And once again, you'd also have tip wear occurring based on where it's sitting. Let's switch to an oval track. Now, oval track, we have an option of seeing how sealed track, which encounters more internal wear, what that would do. So here you can see how the natural operation is kind of stretching and pulling those links. That's what it causes the increased pitch. And I will pause this for a second. Notice where the bushings are riding. They are riding up higher on the tip because the track pitch is longer. They're riding up there and they're causing greater tip wear. Also note that it's engaging in every other sprocket tooth. I know we didn't point that out until this point. These sprockets have an odd number of teeth and it's called a hunting tooth design, so that each time around there, it will engage a different sprocket, which spreads out the wear evenly during operation. Same thing with this track. We can also flip to a worn sprocket. Worn sprocket has sharper teeth. Now, notice the worn sprocket, it's riding more in the root area down in the center. That is if our track pitch is correct. And packing. Snow is probably not the most likely, but mud and dirt packing in there, it will cause it to ride up near the tip. If we go back, we also can see some animations showing track adjustment. So here is our ideal elevated track. You'll notice that the track sags a little, hangs down a little in between the sprocket and the front idler. Now here's an elevated track that's too tight. It's more of a straight line. It's not hanging down, sagging down. We can see the same with an oval track. Oval track, ideal. There's a little bit of sag on the top of it. If you think about Caterpillar's name, they got their name from the track. It looked like a caterpillar crawling and moving. You can kind of see that on the top of the track here. It's going up and down. When it is too tight, like in this animation, there is no up and down. It is more of a straight line. And you do not see that. So remember your ideal conditions, especially operators need to be able to check that on a daily basis. As mechanics, when we set it, we often measure it. At least you should be measuring it and setting it according to specifications. So this is the ideal for an oval track, and this is the ideal for an elevated track. This is a very helpful animation that Caterpillar made. Unfortunately, it works on Flash Player, and I'm not sure how much longer it will work, so I wanted to share this video with you. Thank you.